Welcome to the Embrace Virtual Forum Series. My name is Dr. Sarah Sammons, and I am a breast medical oncologist and the associate director of the Embrace Metastatic Breast Cancer Program at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute in Boston, Massachusetts. For those of you who may be joining us for the first time, throughout the year in our Embrace Forum Series, we host monthly educational webinars for you to learn from Dana-Farber's team of experts about treatment, research, and the care of metastatic breast cancer. Today, we have a very special event planned. And during our event, Dr. James Tulsky will explain the difference between palliative care and hospice and discuss important conversations that you may want to have with your care team early on and throughout your care. Next, Amanda Moment, a social worker at Brigham and Women's Hospital, will discuss how to engage in honest and brave conversations with loved ones about what you need and what you're feeling with your MBC diagnosis. After both presentations, I will moderate a question and answer session with both Dr. Tulsky and Amanda. So please be sure to add any questions that you may have to the queue by clicking the Q&A button on the bottom of your screen and typing in your questions. Please be aware that if you enter a question into the chat, it might be missed, and so please be sure to place it in the Q&A button. Now, it is my absolute honor to introduce you all to Dr. James Tulsky. Dr. Tulsky is the Porvu Jaffe Chair of the Department of Psychosocial Oncology and Palliative Care at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. He is the Chief of the Division of Palliative Care at Brigham and Women's Hospital and a Professor of Medicine at Harvard Medical School. Dr. Tulsky has published widely in the areas of clinician and patient communication, quality of life in serious illness, how to talk to patients and how patients can talk to their doctors about serious illness, particularly for patients with advanced cancer. And he is the founding director of Vital Talk, which is a nonprofit devoted to communication skills, teaching and promoting a vision that every patient with serious illness will be surrounded by clinicians who can speak about matters most and match care to their values. Welcome, Dr. Tulsky. We are so happy to have you, and thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sammons. It's an honor to be here, and I'm really grateful for this opportunity to speak to all of you about this really important topic. So let me just start with a little bit about what we're going to talk about, and you can go to the next slide. And what I'd like to do here is to have you conduct a little thought experiment. So imagine, and you can go to the next, imagine that you've been planning for a long time, a much needed and well-deserved vacation to a beautiful tropical island in the Caribbean. And so you're really excited about this trip and you're looking forward to it. Next. But you're then looking at the news reports. And what you see is that there is a tropical storm, possibly even a hurricane, that could be heading to the region that you're traveling to. Now, as you can see on this, it's a 30% probability that this might actually happen. And so, you know, what do you do next? You start imagining that beautiful trip on the left of kind of hanging out by the, you know, lovely serene ocean could turn into this picture on the right of, you know, devastation on the island that you are hoping to travel to. And so I'm just going to actually stop for a moment and ask people to share in the chat very quickly, you know, what are your thoughts about what you would do next? You can just throw this into the chat, and hopefully I will be able to see this. So if you You wouldn't go. Okay, that's from Sarah. So that's choice, right? One choice is you can just decide not to do it. It appears that I am not able to see what everybody might be writing in the chat. So that's unfortunate. What I was going to say, so hopefully you are writing things in the chat, and I can imagine that, you know, the choice not to go, the choice to plan differently. You can go to the next slide. You know, one thing that some people might think about is actually getting travel insurance, right? And saying, okay, I'm going to continue to go, but I want a way to bail out of there if I need to, right? So go on to the next slide, please. So next. So here you are. And what I'm going to talk about, and what we're going to really talk about, is imagine that a piece of your planning is preparing a suitcase. And so, you know, this was the original suitcase you were going to bring, right? It was all sun hats and shorts and flip-flops. And next, please. And then you learn the news. Next. And, you know, you could continue to pack your suitcase for that sunny forecast, because in fact, that might be what's going to happen. Next. Or you could actually think about planning your suitcase for rain. Maybe it won't be devastating, you know, hurricane, but maybe it's just going to have a lot more rain, and yet it would still be worth the trip, right? So there's this notion of packing two different suitcases for the same trip, and being in a mindset and being able to be prepared no matter where that trip takes you. And so obviously I'm using this metaphor for what we might think about when you're living with an advanced cancer and you don't know, right? In today's era of amazing treatments, you know, what we're all hoping for is the possibility that the treatments are going to be effective for a very, very long time and keep you as healthy and well and living as high a quality of life as possible. And yet, being honest with ourselves, we know that there's always a possibility that those treatments stop becoming effective, that the side effects become too burdensome, that things happen that change the trajectory, and that then it's not going to be the forecast that you were hoping for. And so how do you live in this place of both things at the same time? Next. So what we're going to talk about is, first of all, how to think a little bit about what the future might hold. Next. How we balance both our hopes and our worries, both of which are realistic. We're also going to talk about what palliative care is and when it's appropriate. Next. And we're also going to speak about communicating with your oncology team. And finally, next, we're going to speak about how do you talk to your family. I'm going to sort of cover the first three pieces of this, and Amanda's going to do most of the second two pieces. Next. So first of all, there's a lot of research on this, and it is extremely natural, really normal to swing between these feelings of hopefulness or even hopelessness. And, you know, there might be moments that you're just really worried and you don't think things are going to go well. And that's a real feeling. And you can try to run away from it, or you can sort of live with that and go, okay, this is kind of how I am in this moment. And then there are times you're going to feel a whole lot more hopeful. And some of this might be driven by sort of how you're feeling in the moment, like when you have a good day versus when you have a bad day. It might be because of a scan result you get one way or the other, but it might be, you know, disconnected from any of that, where you're just kind of going through your day and you kind of have these moments that kind of hit you. So the first thing I just wanted to say is that is normal. We swing, we vacillate between sort of how we are feeling about our own prognosis and how we're likely to do. And then that's going to affect sort of how we're feeling day to day. Next. And the next thing I wanted to say is that thinking about the future is both exciting and scary. It's exciting because there are I'm assuming for all of you, there are so many things to look forward to with your own life, with your families, you know, children, jobs, careers, all those things. At the same time, it's scary. It's scary to imagine that things might not go the way you want, and that some of the things you were really looking forward to might be lost. And so for a lot of us, when we have those kind of negative thoughts, it just kind of feels better to just stuff them away. And we're just going to sort of pretend that doesn't exist and force ourselves to think positively. And sometimes we can do that to a degree, but the truth is it usually doesn't work very well to completely stuff it away. Next. Next. And one of the reasons for this is that if you don't have any prognostic awareness, and by this I mean the not a realistic knowledge of what the future might hold, is it that 30% number you saw in the forecast? Is it a different number? Is it, you know, a prognosis about your function or about survival? If you don't know that, you can't make decisions and reflect what you really want. And so many of us, I'll just say that in my own practice, I worry when people are unwilling to think about this at all, because I worry that a time will come when decisions need to get made, oftentimes medical decisions. And because someone found it too hard to go through that thinking process, we don't really know what they want. And then we may or may not give them the care that matches what matters most to them. Next. Next. So the other thing is, we actually have a whole bunch of research data now that shows that people who can hold both things at the same time, that is hopefulness for a good outcome in the future, as well as a realistic recognition that things may not go the way you hope, actually enjoy a higher quality of life throughout their illness. So pure positive thinking, which is kind of the way we've always thought before, may not be the only way to go, may not be the best way to go. Next. So, you know, there's this idea, I would say that a lot of people think that the options are either are kind of like either or. You could only be thinking about your hopes, or you could only be thinking about your worries. Next. But what we're hoping today is to get all of you thinking a little bit about what it might mean to be thinking about hopes, both hopes and worries at the same time. And if not maybe at the exact same time, at least holding them in sort of, you know, in the same general sphere. Next. So before I move on, I want to talk a little bit about emotions, because let's just be honest, that's what's at stake here, or that's what's happening. When you have these negative thoughts, it triggers negative emotions. Those negative emotions are fear, sadness, anger, frustration, a whole bunch of other stuff. And then the question is, what does that do to us? Next. So one of the things we know is that emotion floods our cognition. So, you know, as in medicine, we like to think of sort of two parts of the brain. There's the higher brain up here, which is where your cognition happens, where you really think through logically things. And then there's kind of the more basal areas of your brain, sort of down here, which are driving the emotion. And what happens is, when you get very, very emotional, we actually have studies from functional MRIs that show that those basal part of your brain, which has the emotion, will light up. And when that lights up, the frontal part of your brain that actually helps you think clearly actually shuts down. It goes dormant. Now, in a sense, you all already know that, right? But it adds scientific confirmation to this idea that when we are emotional, highly emotional, we don't necessarily think as well as we would want to. And so it says something about, you know, the need for us to think about how we manage those emotions, so that we then can, because they're going to happen, so that we can then get ourselves to a place where we can think clearly about things. Next. And I want to share with you an example of how this plays out. This is from a research study that a colleague of mine at the University of Washington did. And they were asking people before and after conversations with their doctors about what they, I'm sorry, the phone here is doing something weird. Just trying to stop it. They were asking their doctors before and after about what they thought their likelihood of survival was. And they asked both the doctors and the patients. Next. So they asked this patient before, this is with AML, acute myelogenous leukemia. This is a different disease than breast cancer. And they asked the patient before her visit with her doctor what she thought the likelihood of was of cure from this disease. She wrote down 90 to 100%. This is what she was thinking. This is what she was hoping. Next. This is what the oncologist actually said to her during the consultation. Next. So if you had 100 people, the survival curve drops down because people die of one thing or another, including relapse. That tends to level off at about 2.5 years after transplant and stays level after that. It's about 30% in your situation. I know this is very technical language, but this is what the person said, better or for worse. Okay, so that's what the oncologist said. Next. They then asked the oncologist to write down what he thought the likelihood was of cure for this woman. He wrote 30%. Okay, next. They then afterwards asked the patient what she recalled from that conversation. Here's what she said. Next. After he said the 30%, he just kept digging along in his facts and I was stunned. Literally, my note-taking was completely done. All I did was wrote 30% the rest of the time all over my paper. I mean, I just couldn't get past that point. I don't know how to describe it. So this is a great, painful example of someone being thoroughly overwhelmed by information that was given to her that was very negative. And she became appropriately and naturally very emotional. And she, you know, she was just writing 30%, 30%, because that's what she heard from the doctor, right? They then asked her, what do you think is the likelihood of cure from this disease? Next. And what did she write? 90 to 100%. So even after hearing this, even after writing 30% all over her paper, when they asked her what she thought the survival was, she still said 90 to 100%. Now, there's a lot of potential explanations for that. One is that this is what she's hoping for rather than what she actually believes. But the other is that she was so flooded emotionally that, in fact, she never was even able to change the logic in her own mind of what it was she was hearing. And the unfortunate part here is that that's going to change, again, what suitcases she packs for this trip. It's going to change if it's a 90 to 100% forecast or a 30% forecast. Next. So how do I make sense of all this? Next. So first of all, it's really important to talk to your team and find out what your oncologist is thinking. As a palliative care clinician, many people, I ask all of my patients what their understanding is about their illness and what they, you know, what they've heard from the other doctors. And too many of them share that they don't really know what the answers are. And in some cases, people just don't want to know, and that's one thing. But in some cases, people do want to know, but maybe the information hasn't been given them directly. Maybe it was given to them at a time when they were too emotional to hear it, and the same thing happened to them as just happened in that previous example. But in any case, what I recommend is when you feel you're in the emotional state that you can manage it, it is important to talk to your team and find out what your oncologist is thinking and ask them those tough questions if you want to know the answers to. They themselves may struggle with the answer based on what the data shows, but they can give you their best estimate. Next. It's also really important to get support and talk to professionals and other patients and learn how people cope with this. We're giving a talk now for an hour. This is not something that we can, you know, give you all the coping strategies and how to manage this in this period of time. What we can say is that if you're really finding it hard to do so, if you're finding that the emotion is just overwhelming on this, that professional support is very helpful. And, you know, frequently that means a social worker. It could mean other professionals as well. As well as, you know, talking to colleagues and peers and other patients, although be careful, because sometimes other patients can be extremely helpful for you. Oftentimes they can be very helpful as peers. And sometimes people will kind of encourage strategies that are not necessarily the best coping, like always forcing positive thinking. Next. And then the other thing is to get palliative care. And I'm going to talk a little bit about this, because this is, if you do see a palliative care clinician, I hope and the likelihood is that they will help you with some of these issues. Next. So I said get palliative care. So what is palliative care? Next. So palliative care, and you can just kind of click through it down. So is, first of all, it's specialized medical care for people who are living with serious illness. Palliative care is provided for all different serious illnesses. Obviously here at Dana-Farber, it's all about cancer. But you know, we also provide, for example, at Brigham and Women's Hospital, we have palliative care for people living with advanced heart disease or kidney disease. Palliative care provides relief from symptoms. That's a big focus of what we do, pain, shortness of breath, fatigue, et cetera, as well as stress. And our focus is really on improving quality of life for both patient and family. And this last bullet is the one that we really feel is important for people to know. It's appropriate at any age, at any stage of illness, and to know that this is not just something that we recommend for people who are at the very end of life. I have a palliative care practice at Dana-Farber. I have patients in my practice I've been following for 5 or 6 years, and hopefully have been able to be helpful to them during that time period. Next. And the last bullet there was just that it can be provided together with cancer-directed treatment, that this is not at all an either or. Palliative care is an and with. Next. So, and you know, the language we like to use is that palliative care is an extra layer of support. And that's an extra layer of support to what your oncology team is already giving you. Next. So a question that comes up very frequently is, how does palliative care differ from hospice care? Next. So you can go next on this. So palliative care, like I've said, is appropriate at any point in illness, and it's provided at the same time as life-prolonging treatments. You know, many of my patients, most of them, are on active cancer therapy, they're on clinical trials, they're doing all sorts of things to try to stave off the cancer and live as long as possible. There's no prognostic requirement. Like I said, I take care of many patients over many years, and we like it that way. And there's no need to choose between treatments. So you can get palliative care and you can get whatever advanced oncology care is available to you. Next. Hospice, in contrast, is limited for people in the last weeks or months of life. And in order to be enrolled in hospice care, two physicians have to sign off that this patient, you know, on average, patients in this situation would live for less than 6 months. And once you enroll in hospice, it's very different. What happens is your insurance coverage changes. And so it focuses on providing all the hospice services, but you may need to give up coverage for disease-directed treatments at this point, because the focus is now on all the comfort-oriented things. And as a result, you get more services provided as part of that. Most hospice care, like 90% of hospice care, is given in people's homes. They stay in their home in the same situation they've been in before. Hospice almost always wants to know that you have somebody there who can help care for you, usually a family member or a friend. you can also have higher professional caregivers to come and help out as well if that's necessary. And then hospice provides a number of services. They have a nurse who comes to visit you at least weekly, oftentimes more frequently than that if the need is there. They provide a social worker who come to the house, and all these people come to your house. A social worker comes, they provide a chaplain. They will provide you all your medications, frequently bringing them into the home. They'll provide all the home medical equipment that's necessary and so forth. So the idea is to help somebody stay at home as long as possible. Like I said, that's about 90% of hospice care that's given in the home, and maybe about another 10% or so is given in hospice facilities, hospice houses. And that's when symptoms are either too difficult to manage at home, that you really need a different kind of environment, or for whatever other reason, it's just too hard to stay at home. So I think I'm going to stop there and then hand it over to Amanda.
Thank you so much, Dr. Tulsky. Okay, now we have Amanda. Amanda Moment is a palliative care social worker who has been in practice on the intensive palliative care unit at Brigham and Women's Hospital for 16 years, providing direct support to patients and families, facilitating goals of care discussions, and providing education on communicating with kids about serious illness. She is an educator who teaches across disciplines and specializes in advanced illness communication, work sustainability, and legacy planning. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Amanda.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Sammons and Dr. Tulsky. I'm glad to be here with all of you today. So during this session, we'd like to spend some time thinking about how to engage the people we care most about in some of the hardest conversations, what the future may hold, how to prepare. So before we get to families, I wanted to begin with the idea that we often need to anchor our discussions with our families in what we're hearing from our medical providers, as Dr. Tulsky was describing, with that prognostic awareness, what to expect. And so some of you may have already raised this topic with your medical teams and may have heard, rightly so, that we can be terrible about predicting what's ahead, depending on how treatments work or how cancers behave. Giving concrete answers is hard. So for this reason, I wanted to let you in on some of the tricks of the trade that may help you narrow down the information and ask your medical teams to give you more specific information. Next slide. So the first strategy is to ask your teams to tell you what they think the best and the worst case scenarios are. So if they're vague when you say, you know, I'm really hoping to understand how much time is this treatment going to give me, or what can I expect moving forward? If the answer is a little bit vague, you can say, could you tell me what you think the best and the worst case scenarios might be? Providers tend to be better at ranges than at specific numbers, so this language can actually be helpful for both you and them. Another way to think about it is to ask, well, what's possible, and then also what's most likely? So these frames can sometimes help. Another way to approach it is to speak with your teams based on your hopes and goals, to let them know what's important in your life. So if it's important to get to a future graduation, or if you're planning a family wedding, or even travel out of the country, it's helpful to speak with your providers about this, because in the very least, they may be able to help adjust a treatment schedule to make sure that you are feeling okay for the event that you're hoping for. And additionally, they might have an opportunity to tell you if they worry that you could grow sicker before the event occurs, and talk to you about adjusting your plans and timelines. So it can be really helpful for your providers to know, what are the things you are doing treatment for? What are the things that matter to you? And how they can dovetail your care and your treatment based on that. The third strategy is a question we often ask of each other, which is the surprise question. And this question goes something like this: would you be surprised if something were to happen within 6 months? Or would you be surprised if I got too sick to attend this thing that I'm hoping for next year? It may indicate, even if something isn't likely, that it still may not be surprising, and it could give you an extra piece of information. So hopefully a couple of these strategies may help you follow up, some of the conversations you're having with your medical team to get a little bit more concise information. Next slide. So when I use the word family, talking to your family, I want to be clear that we're talking about both chosen family and family of origin, and they don't always overlap, and they each may have their own challenges. And we'll talk a little bit about challenging families later. Many of our LGBTQ plus patients, think in terms of their chosen family. So it's really critical for you to think about family however you define it. So in thinking about the timing of when to have these conversations, these can occur from diagnosis forward. So I work with some families who say, the minute I got the diagnosis, I sat my family down, I talked to them about what was important to me, we called a lawyer, we did some paperwork, we kind of got a bunch of things checked off our list, and then we focused on treatment and living. And then I talk to other families who say, we've really never had these conversations, and we're not sure where to start with it all. And so they can happen, but they don't always from the beginning. We also see that talking in a setting of calm rather than crisis can be more helpful. I'm an inpatient social worker, so I see people when they're admitted to the hospital. And I can't tell you the number of people who say to me, I'm here in crisis, and I really wish we had tried having some of these conversations before things got hard. Another piece about timing is that these conversations often increase as the disease moves forward, oftentimes early on in treatment, or so focused on, what treatments might offer us, what to expect, what the symptoms are like, and kind of navigating our lives, that we may not have a lot of these conversations, but as things progress or as we're going through different treatments or scans, we may start having more and more of these discussions. And we want to think about having these likely as a number of smaller conversations. So a series of smaller conversations, not just one big one and done, because our thoughts and feelings may change over time, and it may help us acclimate to having little bits of information that kind of occur naturally. So I think the chat is working again. I'm just going to invite, if it's possible, for people to just throw in the chat, why might families not choose to talk to each other? What do you see as some of the barriers to having open communication? Let's see if the chat's working now. Too emotional. Yep. Avoid the inevitable, make the family too worried. Potentially financial. Mm-hmm. Scary. Yep, absolutely. Avoidance, too sad. Not understanding. Talking about illness is uncomfortable or it's just too scary. Yep. Can't face reality. Fear. Absolutely. Absolutely. Worried about increasing anxiety for children. Yep. Yep. Excellent. All right, next slide. Absolutely. So you all have honed in on many of the primary reasons. So oftentimes fear is the primary reason that people don't have more open communication. Sometimes people can worry that they'll be perceived as giving up on yourself or on others. Sometimes people will share with me, patients have said, I worry that if I'm planning for the worst, that in some way undermines faith, what it means to have faith. And we've been able to talk about the idea that faith and planning are not necessarily in opposition. And as Dr. Tulsky was saying, the idea of insurance, there are plenty of people who have faith and still have insurance. The idea that talking about it makes it real. A lot of people who are going through illness, think carefully about this mind over matter piece, how I approach my illness, manifests itself in how well I do. And so does talking about the harder things make it real, make it happen. Or this idea of causing pain to the people we love. I will often hear from families, when we're having good days, I feel like, well, I don't want to ruin the good day by having a difficult conversation. But when we're having a bad day, it's that much scarier to bring up the hard things. Other reasons may be that it may not be culturally aligned. Not every culture feels that communicating openly about what's ahead is appropriate or healthy. Sometimes we're just busy, busy with daily needs, busy with work, caregiving, medical appointments. You know, sometimes if you're a couple navigating, say, family or caregiving, you know, you're kind of navigating separate tasks just to get everything done. And also I hear a lot from people, I just don't know how to begin. So if it's so hard to do, why might it be helpful to do? And I know Dr. Tulsky referenced some of this, and I want to be clear that, you know, we are not trying to be prescriptive. Open communication may not be right for every family or every particular person in your family, but let's talk about some of the potential benefits. Next slide. So when serious illness happens, it's really normal that most people are having private thoughts and worries about what lies ahead. And often this private worrying can feel scary and isolating and can sometimes kind of amplify in the echo chamber of our own heads. And talking with our families or our loved ones can help us feel more connected and not worry alone. And, you know, it's, well, I'll come back to this piece, but this idea of feeling more connected as we each worry. Another piece is that avoiding the unknown actually requires energy. It takes energy from us without us even realizing it. So if you can kind of picture in school when there was an upcoming exam, sometimes worry about the exam took more mental energy than just sitting down and studying for it. And so sometimes, like an illness, having targeted conversations can help us settle some of those concerns that we've been pushing away and allow us to actually put energy back into the things that we want. Similarly, practical planning, sometimes we need to put things in place and we need time to do that. So whether it's consulting with a lawyer or taking a trip, you often just need time to prepare, especially if you're responsible for the care of children, elders, or other dependents. It's often critical to have time to put a plan in place, even if it's a just-in-case plan that you hope never to need. And the idea is that this could bring some peace of mind. And then sometimes it feels important to leave a part of ourselves behind for those we love that we call legacy work. And this can take many forms, whether a written project, specific items that you want to go to loved ones, documenting a family history or family recipes or prayers, things like that. And these can bring meaning to us in a time of illness. Who are we? What are we, you know, who are we to the people we love? And it can offer meaning and connection for our loved ones later as well. And we can talk more about this in the Q&A if it's helpful. Next slide. So each of these could be its own presentation and we don't have time to delve in individually, but these are just some of the topics you might choose to talk about with your families. And I'm sure each of us could add 30 more. And if you have burning questions about specific topics from this, please feel free to put them in the chat or in the Q&A. Next slide. So before you delve into any of these conversations with your loved ones, I wanted to offer a few tips about how you might prepare for this, especially if you're unsure how your family may respond to the idea of talking. There's this wonderful online guide called The Conversation Project. I would recommend all of you checking out if you haven't yet. And it expands on some of these recommendations and helps you prepare more fully. But I wanted to highlight a few points. Next line. And next line, please. So first, you want to think about who should be included in these conversations. Sometimes you might choose to speak to people separately. Sometimes you might choose to gather your family together, but think a little bit about who you want involved in a conversation. Next slide, please. Or next, thank you. So you want to think about setting a time and day. There are some families that have relative ease with these discussions and may be able to do conversations like this while they're washing dishes together. But for a lot of families, the idea of being able to kind of prepare for a difficult conversation or kind of know that they can anticipate it by setting a time and a day can help them kind of get their mindset ready for it. Next line, please. And it's important to understand, you know, what questions do I want to cover? What are my goals for this conversation? What do I want to, you know, talk about for all of this? And what questions might come up from the family that I'm asking to attend? Next line, please. So this idea of talking about talking really means that before delving into really difficult content, we can talk with our families a little bit about what does it feel like to be sitting down to talk about some of these things. You know, I might be a little nervous. Are you nervous too? Are there things you want to make sure that we don't talk about today or that might be too hard? Next line, please. So you can explore the degree of information your loved ones may want to have as you're thinking about the future or you're talking about what to expect. Not everybody may want the same amount of information, and so kind of establishing where each person stands can be helpful. Next line, please. Once again, we think about this not just as one big conversation where you need to cover everything that's important, but a series of conversations. And maybe today, maybe our goal is to just write a long list of some of the things that have been on our mind and not delve into any of them yet. Or maybe there's one thing that's more pressing than everything else. Like maybe I just want to talk to a lawyer and that's my number one goal. You know, and you say, for today, I'd love to talk about this. And maybe we'll set a list of things to talk about at our next conversation. Next line, please. And then because we think of this as a series of conversations, and if you have a family that doesn't easily sit down to do this, you might want to set a time to revisit. When will we come back and talk about this? When will we kind of share the work we've been able to do, or when will we get to the other topics? Next, please. And then as Dr. Tulsky was saying, emotion is normal. And we're all going to bring our own way of experiencing emotion to these conversations. And so just to say, it is normal and expected. And I think people often feel like they have to protect one another from emotion. But I think it's important to just understand you're human beings talking about hard things. Expect emotion. It's normal, natural, and it's a part of the process. Next, please. So because it's always helpful to have language to use, here are a few examples you could use with your families just to initiate these conversations. Next, I've been thinking about the future and wanted to know if we could talk about it together. Next, it might help me to think about some of the what-ifs in my illness. Would you help me with this? Next, when Uncle Jerry died, I started thinking about what I would want in his circumstances. I'd like to talk it over with you if you're open to it. Next, I want to put some plans in place in case I get sicker so we won't have to worry. Next, so you know your family's best, you know what kinds of things are going to work, but these are just some generic ways to begin with the people that you love. All right, next, please. So I just wanted to say a word about complex families. Many of us have complex people or families in our lives already, and talking about serious illness and future planning can feel really tricky. We might be estranged from people. There may be people we haven't talked to in years. We may not want to plan with the people who are closest to us, or the people who are closest to us may not want to plan at all, or they may have their own mental health or high-risk needs that makes it hard for us to feel like we can bring this to them without making them more fragile. And so these kinds of relationships may require different strategies. So perhaps your planning needs to take place elsewhere, with a trusted friend, with a spiritual advisor, a social worker, or a medical provider, or maybe a lawyer, or you document your wishes, in writing in a safe place. Perhaps you take steps to put things in place that you know your family may not be able to face. I worked with a woman who said, you know, I have a relatively good prognosis. I'm hoping to live years with this, but I've already put my plans for my funeral in place because I don't think my husband's going to be able to face it. And I just want to get that settled so my kids don't have to worry about it. Or perhaps you want to have these conversations with the complicated people in your life, and you just want more support in doing so. So you can ask a counselor or a spiritual advisor to help you navigate difficult family dynamics. You can ask a medical provider to facilitate a family meeting where the provider shares hard medical information, and then you don't have to be the go-between for some of that difficult news. Or you could ask a friend or an ally to sit down with you and the complicated person just to give you an added layer of support. We talk a lot in palliative care about never worrying alone. And so we hope that some of today's information and tips will help you feel more prepared for how to hope for the best and prepare for the worst with your providers and with your loved ones. There are just a couple of resources that I'd love to see in the next slide. And then we're happy to open things up to your questions. So as I had mentioned before, the conversation project is wonderful, and I recommend everybody going straight there to check out some of their strategies. Also, Dr. Ira Byack does a lot of teaching about how the kinds of categories of topics that people may communicate with in their family systems, including things like how to express appreciation and gratitude, how to ask for or give forgiveness. And then there are things like the caregiver affidavit, which is just one tool that can be used from a legal standpoint. So if there is an adult who has dependent children, young children, and they want to be able to temporarily give someone they trust the authority to, say, speak to the kids' schools or to the kids' medical providers, something like the caregiver affidavit is something you can do. And this is for Massachusetts. I don't know. I assume there's equivalents in other states that allows people to get help from trusted sources. And so there are things like this in addition to talking to a lawyer about a will or a trust or things like that. And then, of course, as we were saying, accessing emotional and spiritual providers and palliative care, either in the setting that you're getting treatment in or in the community. All right, I'm going to leave it there.
Amanda, thank you so much. This has been wonderful. And now we are actually going to open it up to questions. And so you can either use the Q&A or I can also look in the chat. The Q&A was disabled before, but I think it's back up and running. And all right, here we go. This is just more of a share. In my case, I have conversation with my family and friends because I want and need them. It's actually very therapeutic for me to be able to talk to my family members because, and maybe it's too much, but it's part of me taking good care of myself. Yeah, I mean, I would totally agree. And maybe Amanda, you could weigh in on sort of the therapeutic effects of having these conversations with family members and how relieving it must be open and share and then facilitate the support that you need because your family also doesn't know what support you need unless you're talking about it.
Absolutely. We talk to a lot of people who say there's just a lot of peace of mind in being able to verbalize the things that matter to you and to be able to get the support from your family. And so, especially if you have a family system that easily tolerates these conversations or that loves you enough to cope with these conversations, even if they don't prefer them, that's a wonderful thing.
Yeah. I have another great question here. I am the husband of a patient. I need some help dealing with sadness and worry and how this will affect my daughter. How can I find appropriate care and support?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's an excellent question, Larry. And I don't know how young or old your daughter is. But usually the social worker who is, connected to the treatment center should be able to talk to you more about parenting at a difficult time and trying to offer support to you. It may be that there's an amount of support that you want privately in order to process your grief and sadness so that as you turn to your daughter, you can feel like you can remain as centered as possible. And then sometimes the possibility is that we can have providers give us permission to have some emotion in front of our loved ones. It normalizes for our loved ones that it's okay for them to have the emotion too. And so there are counselors often through medical centers, but also in the community who specialize in illness and grief and can certainly help people get connected.
I do know that our Dana-Farber social workers will do family counseling. And so if, your spouse is a Dana-Farber patient, the first step would be asking the medical team for a social work referral, but specifically with the needs of family counseling. And, the social workers can also help in discussions with children of all ages, older, younger, the appropriate language to use, all of that. So it really, it generally starts with counseling through social work. Another good question for Dr. Tulsky, what sort of services are provided through palliative care?
So it, to some extent, depends on where you're getting your care. I can speak to what we have at Dana-Farber and most comprehensive cancer centers. What you would be receiving is there would be a trained palliative care clinician, physician, and or a nurse practitioner who will see you and will, you know, have regular visits with you like any other sort of clinic visits, either face-to-face or virtual, and will help work through and manage your symptoms, as well as have conversations about things like the future and so forth. So that's the really the primary service that's afforded. Then there may be accompanying social workers that are part of that palliative care team, or for example, Dana-Farber, we work together with our regular oncology social workers. And in some places, there will be a palliative care pharmacist who can also help manage. Sometimes the medications, particularly in pain, can get quite complicated. And so we have, here at Dana-Farber, we have palliative care pharmacy specialists who could also help support you. There, through most cancer centers, there usually is not a home team. However, there are a number of agencies that provide home palliative care for people for whom leaving the house is difficult. Like I mentioned before, a lot of that care can be done virtually by, for example, you know, I can have a virtual visit with you in the home, but if actually a visit is needed to see the person and to sort of lay hands, then a lot of agencies, many of the agencies that have hospices also have palliative care programs that are part of those agencies, and then they can send somebody out to the home and check in and do that sort of thing. But it's not as full as the complete range of services that exists in hospice.
Next question is palliative care and or hospice something the patient raises with their doctor or the oncologist recommends? I can just speak very briefly from an oncologist perspective, and then potentially Dr. Tulsky can weigh in. So I often bring up palliative care with my patients, you know, very early on, and I will bring up palliative care for patients who have needs that I don't feel I'm addressing adequately in my 20 to 30 minute meeting with them. A lot of the times, you know, in those meetings, we're talking about, is the treatment working? What are the treatment side effects? What's the next treatment? And then we have 5 minutes to spend on all of the other things, pain, hot flashes, anxiety, depression, you know, all of those things. And it's just not enough time. And so if I don't feel like I'm serving my patient well enough in the symptoms that they're having from their cancer burden, it could be trouble sleeping, insomnia, it could be pain, it could be just adjustment disorder, just their adjustment, you know, mentally and emotionally to the diagnosis, then I'm going to recommend a palliative care referral, but you can certainly always bring it up with your doctor. Dr. Tulsky?
I think you said it beautifully, and I think that's exactly the point. It's not that the oncologist can't necessarily do a lot of these things, but they have a half hour visit or however much time to deal with like all this treatment decision making and that goes with that. It's like, it's complex stuff. When I see a patient, I have half an hour to only talk about pain and all these other symptoms. So some of it is that division. And then of course there are examples where, you know, we are more likely to use certain kinds of pain medication, certain kinds of things that are a little less in the comfort zone of some of our oncology colleagues. So why we do that, you know, it is relatively easy. So hopefully, you know, your oncologist will bring it up in the way that Dr. Salmons just said. If they don't, then absolutely you can bring it up and raise the question as to whether or not that would be helpful for you. And my experience is usually they'll say, sure, they'll be happy to do that. I would be a little wary of one response that you sometimes will hear, which is, oh, you're not ready for palliative care. And that's one that is kind of disconcerting because, as I mentioned before, there's not a ready or not. The question is, are you getting your needs met? And if you feel like there are things that could be handled, then I think it's worth bringing up. So what I would say is raise it if it hasn't come up and it's something that you think you could benefit from. If you're doing great and you feel like your needs are being met, your symptom needs and all that by your oncology team, then you're good.
Another similar question, how do oncologists determine if a patient needs hospice?
So what I would say is, so the decision, the real branch point is whether or not the patient's going to continue to get cancer-directed therapy. That's really it. If the patient's going to still get, you know, chemotherapy or sometimes, or, you know, complex hormonal therapies or other things like that, immunotherapy, then they're unlikely to be able to go on hospice. I'll be very honest, this is a financial decision. Hospices can't usually afford to cover expensive cancer treatment drugs and all the other services they're supposed to do. So that's part of why it becomes an either or. And the truth is that in the course of an illness, there often will come a time when the benefit of the cancer-directed therapies is not, you know, is not as great as the burden that those same therapies are giving. And that's a decision point that the oncologist would discuss with the patient. That said, I think the most important thing is that recommendation comes when it matches what the patient's goals are. So, you know, everybody's going to have a different threshold for how much they're willing to put up with in order to try to continue to treat the cancer. And there are some people that, you know, a high burden of side effects is just not worth it. And there are some people that will really push pretty hard through a lot. And so the hospice decision, that decision of like when you're going to stop cancer-directed therapy, is going to sort of depend on that. So I think that's the thinking that goes through the head of most oncologists. But you can certainly make the issue easier if you bring up, first of all, if you raise it, if you're wondering about it, but also for you to think about, does it feel like the benefit I'm getting is worth whatever burdens this treatment may have? The treatments may not have any burdens, but some treatments are very burdensome. And so I think that that's just a very individual discussion.
I agree. I think, you know, there's a few questions on, is hospice being recommended and used by many in Massachusetts? I would say the short answer to that is absolutely. As the inpatient oncology attending last week, I probably sent 8 or 9 patients to hospice. You know, generally we're thinking about hospice when we're not going to give cancer-directed therapy anymore, or chemotherapies, immunotherapies, targeted therapies, and that, you know, either because, you know, we're running out of options that will be effective to treat the cancer, or because the treatments that we're going to give the patient are not in line with their goals. Maybe the only treatments left are, you know, IV chemotherapies that have a lot of side effects. And I've had patients, you know, just opt out of that for hospice services. But we absolutely refer very often. And I have not had issues in Massachusetts with it not being accepted. There was also a question about if Medicare covers palliative care. I have never had them decline to cover. Would you agree, Dr. Tulsky?
Absolutely, yes.
Yes, so Medicare absolutely does cover palliative care. I have room for one more question, which I think is a good one. You know, it sounds like a patient is having a little bit of problem getting the information that they need from their oncologist about, you know, what to expect, some of these really challenging issues with prognosis, what to expect. Any recommendations for that patient?
Amanda, why don't you go first on that?
I mean,
what's that?
Tossing it to Amanda.
I think sometimes, you know, it sounds like you've tried to bring allies with you. It also sounds like sometimes other medical providers can be allies in trying to initiate these conversations. So if there are other If there are NPs, PAs, other physicians who, social workers, anybody else that you work with within the medical system who may be able to also kind of add their voice to these questions or answer you from their own perspectives. I don't know, James, I don't know if you have other thoughts.
Yeah, I think that's it. I mean, I think that there is some level of being insistent. If you are actually seeing a palliative care clinician as well as your oncologist, you can bring this up with the palliative care clinician. There is something about people sometimes feel more comfortable speaking in that setting because they don't want to disappoint their oncologist. And then we, I not infrequently have conversations with my oncology colleagues about sort of what a patient is thinking. And then we try to sort of help navigate this. And sometimes we can filter information back that way. The last thing I'll say is to try to figure out whether you're not getting information because that person really doesn't want to give it, or they're uncomfortable, or they don't like having the conversation, or literally, are they too struggling with knowing what the prognosis might be in the situation? Because sometimes the uncertainty is so great that they themselves are not sure kind of how to answer. But I think then you would want to ask that question specifically.
Great. Well, that's all the time that we have today. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you, Dr. Tulsky. Thank you, Amanda. And thank you for everyone who joined to ask such thoughtful questions.